we have seen that the Atharva Vedic period to the Ayurvedic period starting first century, there was a very big change in the practice of medicine. Essentially, in relation to the practice of medicine, not so much in the theory of medicine, and that is the disappearance, or the largely the disappearance of mantras and rituals. Now, this was because of the influence of Buddhism, which was the dominant religion in India during those 1,000 years. Buddhism not only influenced Ayurveda or practice of medicine, but influenced every other aspect of human endeavor during this period. By questioning the authority of Vedas, Buddha unbarred the gates to inquiry, fearless questioning, which has influenced Indian psyche ever since. In fact, a few hundred years after Buddha, the Indian systems of philosophy like Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Mimamsa, Vedanta, they all questioned Buddhism using the same argument, questioning the authority. This was part of the Indian tradition of questioning. Another, by fiercely opposing slaughter of animals in the name of worship, Buddha succeeded largely in eliminating this cruel practice from all over India. It still remains here and there, but is largely gone. And thirdly, by his constant ministry for 40 years, traveling largely on foot all over North India, and establishing, preaching his noble way by inspired talks, by logical discussions, he created a tradition of spreading true knowledge, winning over people not by force, but by appeal to reason. Now, this was again a tradition which was followed by subsequent great teachers like Shankaracharya. So, in every way, Buddhism was a great influence, and medicine could not remain immune from this change. Now, like earlier, I would like to give the contents of this lecture, because we are covering large areas of time, history of India, because in 20 lectures, I am covering 20 centuries. So, therefore, it is necessary to have some idea of the topics that will be covered in this lecture. First of all, Buddha's condemnation of many ancient rituals, and later on, Buddha accepted many of the traditional practices if they were of benefit to sick people, basic medical doctrines according to Buddhist canon, including good health practices, food and drinks, lifestyle, and so forth. And there are references to diseases, principles of medical treatment, medical procedures, surgical procedures, all these are referred to in Buddhist literature. But we must remember, when we talk about Buddhist literature, what we have are primarily religious texts. So, you cannot expect detailed discussions on anatomy and physiology and diseases. These are essentially religious scriptural texts. There are incidental references to these. So, we are actually gaining information, incomplete information, from these references in what are essentially religious and scriptural works of Buddhism. That deficiency is always there. And then we have a dominant figure, a luminous figure of Jivaka, who was Buddha's physician, and his life and times, which we have forgotten in India largely. But if you go to countries like Vietnam, Japan, that's a very alive, the tradition of Jivaka. We'll have something to say about Jivaka. And the Chinese travelers, as everybody knows, they came here in the 6th century, earlier also. And many of their observations are extremely interesting about the status of Buddhism, and something again incidental references to the practice of medicine. And lastly, spread of Ayurveda all over India. After all, it was Buddhist texts, or Ayurvedic texts, sorry, were written by Charaka, who lived somewhere in Punjab, Kashmir area. Sushruta was based in Banaras, and Vagpada, the third of the Brihatrayi, he was from Sindh. Now, all these texts which were written in the North India, they spread all over India, coming all the way to the remote Kerala. How did it travel? It traveled abroad. It went to Japan, it went to Vietnam, it went to Korea, it went to Tibet, to China. How did it travel? And all this travel took place through Buddhist channels. So that is again a very interesting area. We should pay some attention to looking at that. Now this is essentially, I have already said this, part of the reason this spreading took place, it is because of the sheer personality of the Buddha. If Buddha was associated with the practice of medicine or any other practice, it carried with it a certain seal of approval. That is also another reason why it spread in a way which no other part of Indian cultural heritage has spread with this kind of force all over the world. Buddha is always referred to in Buddhist literature as physician and surgeon. Now, he was a physician in the sense Bhishak, because he removed suffering. People who are suffering from illness, from emotional disturbances, who are suffering, and Buddha was the refuge. Sharanam Gachami. There are any number of instances, people going to him with physical suffering, mental suffering, family problems. Hundreds would go to him. And by his sheer presence, his look, comforting words, he could remove their sorrow. But how could they be called a surgeon? And here there is an interesting reference to this. In Sushruta Samhita, which was around the time of Buddhism, the original Sushruta Samhita, there is a list of foreign bodies, because Sushruta, as you know, was a surgeon. A lot of his surgical procedures had to do with removal of foreign bodies. Now, his list of foreign bodies, splinters, arrowheads, he gives a long list. And along that, grief is also mentioned. In the ancient India, grief was considered foreign to the human body. It has no place within us. It is something foreign. So it has to be removed. And Buddha, since he could remove the sorrow from people, which was something, not sorrow, it is grief. There is a difference. Sorrow is a passing event. It's an episode. But grief, it not only stops the machine, it damages the machinery. It corrodes, stays within, that kind of grief, which a doctor cannot easily remove, but Buddha could. So therefore, he was considered a bhishak also. Now, there is an oldest Buddhist scriptural work is the Teviga Suttas, which many people believe is the earliest utterances of the Buddha. That is what Professor Rice Davids writes. Now, in that Teviga Sutta, you will find Buddha condemning a whole lot of practices, and he calls them low arts and lying practices. These are the terms which Buddha uses. And look at the things, whole series of medical teaching spells to cure snake bites, the mantras being recited when snake bites. Even now you can see it being done. Buddha condemned it. Then procedures to improve virility, induce impotence, all these were practiced at that time. To relieve headache by applying ear drops, collyrium for the eye, for eye diseases, all these Buddha had condemned. But in later literature, especially dealing with Vinaya texts, and Vinaya texts are the set of rules Buddha prescribed for bhikshus. Now, there very detailed instructions are there about their clothes, about their sanitation, about their food. Goes into minutest details about their behavior, conduct. Now, there you will find the same Buddha who had condemned many of these practices, he had softened his condemnation. If he found that something was helping people, even though he may not have been fully convinced, there is a tendency for him to accept. And you will see many examples of this. Look at these. For the use of animal fats in the preparation of food, these are all specifically taken from Mahavagga, which is part of Vinaya texts. For the use of roots of plants, turmeric, astringent decoctions, gums, fruits, salts, these are all, remember, used in Ayurveda even today. For the use of chunam for treating boils and scabs, this is a cauterization. For use nasal purging by using a speculum, that was allowed. These are questions being asked to Buddha, sir, can we use this? And then he would say, yes, you may use it. Bloodletting with horn in intermittent fever, a dreaded disease at that time, and Buddha had specifically permitted that. Use of salves, astringent decoction, fumigation, even excision of proud flesh in chronic ulcers, these are all approved by Buddha. Purgatives for eliminating excess doshas. Administration of a decoction of cow dung as an emetic following ingestion of poisoning. At Jivaka, his personal physician was allowed to treat him himself, and he forbade surgery. There is an example of a Buddhist bhikshu having an anal fistula. He got operated by a surgeon called Akasa Goto, and that ended in severe complication, and the patient developed fecal incontinence, and Buddha was asked, sir, he is not doing well. And when he goes and sees this suffering bhikshu, the first question he asks, how could you get this operation done? He forbade bhikshus getting surgery on themselves. But there is nowhere Buddha condemning the use of surgery in ordinary people. There were two sets of rules. What governed about whether it is drug or the use of food or any other kind of personal conduct or the use of medicine. What applied to the bhikshus, the highly rigid, highly disciplined code, that did not seem to apply to the laity. There is a difference in this. So here, Buddha forbade bhikshus from having any kind of surgery. But there is no evidence that he ever said ordinary people should not get surgery done. And this question becomes important because surgery which flourished during Sushruta's time or even Jivaka's time, later on in the first few centuries of this present era, like 4th, 5th centuries, there was a sharp decline in the practice of surgery, in the prestige which this discipline had, in the prestige the surgeons had. They were all banished into the lower castes. This is what happened by 4th or 5th century. Surgery and surgeons, they declined in public esteem and they were considered lower castes. And this strange happening, sometimes it is attributed to Buddhism. Buddhism was against bloodshed. And after all, a surgeon cannot operate without bloodshed. This was the reason given. But there is no evidence anywhere that I have seen Buddha condemning the use of surgery in ordinary people. This is not seen anywhere. But Buddhist bhikshus, yes, certainly, he did say they should not get this done. Now, the point which I made earlier, when we want to trace the kind of practice of medicine from between the Atharva Veda to Charaka, something like 1,000 years, we have a real dearth of original material. We don't have any medical texts. Obviously, they existed, but we are not able to access them. And from Ayurvedic literature, we know, like Charaka himself, he says, I am redacting an earlier text, Agnivesha Tantra. So, Agnivesha Tantra existed in Buddhist India. We know that it existed, but it is not available. Nobody has seen it. Similarly, there are other texts, perhaps the original of Sushruta Tantra. We have Sushruta Samhita, which was redacted in the 4th century, again based on an earlier text, but that is not available. So, there are a number of original works which existed during that time, none of which is available in an authentic form or a complete form. So, we are forced to depend on Buddhist texts, which are essentially religious, to reconstruct what medical practice was in the Buddhist period. That is a defect that we have. So, therefore, the Buddhist texts that we depend on, the Dīgha Nikāya, which is part of the Buddhist canon dealing with doctrine, and that book, it gives these disciplines as branches of practice of medicine. And Ayurveda is a term they never used. because any term like Veda would not be used in Buddhist texts. So it is called Tikicha, not Chikilsa, it is called Tikicha. That is the term Buddhist books used for practice of medicine. Now here the branches mentioned are Shalya, that is surgery, Chalakya, which is head and neck disease treatment, Kaumarabhritya, treatment of children's diseases, Kaya Chikilsa, internal medicine, Vajikarana, enhancement of sexual potency and fecundity, and also there are references to Vishavidya, treatment of poisoning, and Bhutavidya, which are said to be due to the effect of planets, but also many of those symptoms, they are not ordinary symptoms, not explainable on the basis of ordinary causation, strange diseases, and we would today consider many of them psychiatric illnesses. All these are mentioned in these Buddhist texts, and they cover 7 of the current 8 branches of Ayurveda. But the only one which is left out, Ayurveda has 8 branches, one which is left out is Rasayana. Rasayana is to increase the comforts of old age, getting old without infirmities, high quality living, that kind of thing. This is what Rasayana does. Obviously, the Buddhists, they were not interested in this. They were interested in Nirvana. That could be one reason they eliminated. Rasayana is not mentioned. Otherwise, all the branches are mentioned. Now, the authoritative text that we use in this lecture, where you find most of the medical references, one is Dikha Nikaya and is Milinda Panho. Milinda Panho is a very interesting, perhaps according to many of them, this is one India's answer to Socratic dialogues, because in the form of a very interesting dialogue between King Milinda, he was an Indo-Bactrian king, with Nagasena, a Buddhist teacher, a young Buddhist teacher. It is in the form of dialogue, very powerful, sharp, highly focused, none of the hyperbole of Sanskrit books. And this is the first copy, it was found in Pali, and it is translated, it is a very stirring, in fact, the beginning itself, this Milinda, that king was a very knowledgeable king, and he would keep on asking questions to many of the scholars in those days, and he would defeat everybody. Nobody could answer his questions. And finally, the Buddhists prayed, and in answer to their prayers, Nagasena was born. He was a young boy, probably in his 20s, and Nagasena was camping, and then this Milinda heard a great scholar has come, so he goes to him. And he stopped his chariot outside, went there and met him, and then he asks Nagasena, Nagasena, are you your arms? He said, no. Are you the head? No. Are you the leg? No. So like that, everything he says, no. Then he says, since you have denied all this, I tell you, Nagasena, there is no person called Nagasena. That's how it begins. And Nagasena replies, O king, how did you come here? I came by my chariot. Are the wheels of the chariot the chariot? Like that, he asks all these. Then finally, he says, since you have denied all this, I say, there is no chariot. So that counter questioning, it comes, it's a very, very wonderful dialogue. But within that, you will find many times like Vata, Pitta, Kapha, constitution of the body, illness. Many of these things figure in these dialogues. Extremely interesting. Visuddhimagga, which is written by Buddhaghosa, a very great scholar, who translated all the Buddhist classics, many of which in Sanskrit, into Pali. That is really what has laid the foundation in Sri Lanka. All these Pali translations of Buddhaghosa, that is the foundational text there. And Dhammapada, of course, everybody knows. It is something like Bhagavad Gita, the universal book of Buddhism. And Vinaya Pitaka, I already referred to it. That is dealing with the discipline or the way of life, the code of conduct. All these are dealt with in Vinaya Pitaka, what to eat, how to live. Very great detail, some of it we will have references that later. Now, these are the texts which primarily I have used in collecting information, medical information, which will be of interest to us. And there are also what are called Jataka tales dealing with Buddha's many, many lives. These are stories, but often they are based on what really happened at that time. For example, the teaching of medical students in Takshashila. We have no historical records of what happened in Takshashila, but when you read Jataka tales, you can get a very good idea how the students were taken there, how they were taught, how they were examined. Many of these you will find in very interesting way. You can get information of great value from Jataka tales. Now, the basic doctrines according to Buddhist canon, one is Panchabhuta, as you know. Today in Ayurveda, this is a fundamental doctrine. The five elements, not the elements of the periodic table, but ether, air, fire, water, earth. These five, they constitute the Panchabhutas, and all that you see in the universe, all that you experience in the universe, they are all derived by permutations, combinations, evolution of these five bhutas. This is a fundamental doctrine. Human body and all that you see outside, they are all made of these Panchabhutas. There is complete homology between what exists in the human body, what exists outside. What happens outside to these things will influence us, our body. What happens in the body, however infinitesimal, it will be affecting the universe like that. That, in other words, human body is nothing but a cosmic resonator. That is a fundamental doctrine, and this in the Buddhist you will find in Dikha Nikaya, there are only four, that is Prithvi, up, water, Tejas, light or fire, Vayu, air. Ether is not there. And then later on in Milinda Pandho, in that dialogue which I mentioned, there you find Akasha is added. That becomes five. And later Buddhaghosha describes these, all these five elements, they have characteristic properties like fire, there is heat, light, these are all the characteristics. Akasha is lightness, space, etc. So each of the Prithvi is heaviness. So each of these, there are properties which are characteristic of these bhutas, and what is derived from those in the human body. The tissues, the organs, etc., which are evolved dominance of a particular bhuta, that classification is given by Buddha Ghosha. And Tridosha, another very fundamental doctrine in Ayurveda, we will be discussing all these later on. But here you will find Vishuddhi Magga, again there is reference to Vata, Pitta and Kapha. Their imbalance could cause death. So obviously it had something to do with health and ill health. And Buddha himself says, when the three doshas are in a balanced state, there is happiness. When they are unbalanced, there is unhappiness or grief. And Milinda Pandho says, Vata is perturbed by cold, heat, hunger, thirst, overeating, or as a consequence of karma. These are all accepted in Ayurveda. And Pitta and Kapha, they are perturbed by cold, heat and inappropriate food. These are concepts unexceptionable in Ayurveda. And then look at the human body. Detailed descriptions of body parts. These are all found in Vishuddhi Magga of Buddha Ghosha. Perhaps you find the most detailed descriptions there. And the description of Buddha Ghosha, of all these descriptions, was to create a feeling of revulsion to the human body. And I give one example here. 80 groups of worms, they colonize the interior and exterior of the body. They take birth, they live, they die within the body. The body becomes their place of birth, hospital, graveyard and lavatory. It looks like that is the purpose of this anatomy description by Buddha Ghosha. And the body was believed to account for 32 parts and organs. And the list included many of these tissues. I don't have to read the list. Number of bones mentioned is 300, which is the same as Sushruta has mentioned. Different from Atharva Veda and Charaka. They had mentioned 360. Sushruta had mentioned 300. And here you find 300, which is same as Sushruta's. And the heart is located in the middle of the rib cage, shape of a lotus. It contains some blood. All these descriptions are there in Vishuddhi Magga. Now, good health was highly prized, and here is a quote from Dikhandikaya, health is the highest gain, contentment is the greatest treasure, confidence is the greatest friend, and nirvana is the greatest joy. This is a quote from Dikhandikaya. This is Dhammapada, I'm sorry. It didn't sound like Dikhandikaya, this is Dhammapada. And Dhammapada has many very nice quotes, many of these. Like very much like Bhagavad Gita, you get that impression, quotable, pithy, short statements. And great stress was laid on all aspects of healthcare, which covered food, dining etiquette, hygiene, bath, oral care, eye care, and personal conduct. All these were highly emphasized, and elaborate attention to the construction and use of toilets. This is the only place I have seen such detailed account about constructing toilets and the use of toilets. No Ayurvedic text goes into this, and here it is mentioned the Buddha's one of the groves where the colony was staying. They were openly defecating everywhere, and Buddha saw this and he said, stop, you must have lavatories constructed. And very detailed descriptions are given how it should be done, how there should be privacy, and how a person who is coming, if he wants to go in, he has to cough. That is the sign somebody else wants to come in here. How you should, where you should keep your clothes, how you should clean yourself. These are all mentioned in such great detail, how much attention they paid. None of this our Ayurvedic texts you will find this. It is not mentioned anywhere. But here is the most detailed, some 2-3 pages he describes how the lavatory should be maintained, how it should be cleaned. But that shows the kind of strictness with which they regarded hygiene. It's an eye-opener, something totally surprising to me. And food and drinks in Buddhist India, food was classified as soft, hard, lickable, and beverages. And soft is cooked rice, barley, etc. And hard is tubers, not very, very hard. Because in all the Buddhist stories everywhere where Buddha is entertained or any other person is entertained, they will always find hard and soft, always. It's like idli and sambar, like that. Always they go together. And that was the practice here also. Hard and soft are always served together. And lehya, lickable, and peya, drinking. And commonly used food items, there will be familiar rice, barley, wheat, beans, rice gruel, rice cooked with sesame. That was a very popular, often served. Porridge, rice cake, soups, milk, curd, buttermilk, ghee. These are all mentioned very often. Meats. Meats were often, there was no ban on meats. Meat preparations were very popular. And the meats mentioned include cow, pig, bull, crow, boar, alligator. And remember, Buddha's final meal, the Last Supper, was pork. It was given to him by one of the laborers. He accepted hospitality at dinner. He went and ate, and it was a pork that was served. And then he developed severe abdominal pain, and that was the next day he died. So he would eat pork. The only thing he told the bhikshus, the animal should not be slaughtered just for them. That was the only thing he forbade. If it was a meal being served, a community meal, and a Buddhist bhikshu was being invited, he could go and eat. There was no bar. And salts, pepper, ginger, cumin seeds, all these are what we use today. They were widely used at that time also. And onion and garlic permitted for monks, but not for nuns. Alcoholic drinks, they were widely used. Popular varieties included madhya, sura, five types, asavas, varuni, different types of wines. And Jataka tales allude to the ill effects of consuming excess, because Madhatya Charaka talks about it, people, alcoholism and the evils of alcoholism. That also existed at that time. And the strict code of conduct the bhikshus enjoined in the Vinaya text was not applicable to the laity. And the etiquette for dining was very strict. When the senior monks coming there, everybody has to be served rice, then only the senior monks could eat. All these rules in the dining room were very strictly observed. Now, diseases were known by many names, abatha, amaya, all these terms, synonyms which are used, roga, they are all used in Ayurveda also. And treatment collectively was called tikicha, that was the term Ayurveda, the Buddhist medicine used. They never used the word chikilsa, they never used the word Ayurveda. And the cause of diseases were regarded as eight, which again is very similar to Ayurveda. You will find excess of vata, pitta or kapha, or a combination of these. That comes to four: changes of season, incompatible food, external agencies, and karma, effect of past karma. These were all the considered as the causes of diseases. And Dhammapada regarded hunger as the worst disease. And Dikhanikaya held there were three diseases initially. This is interesting. Start with when humanity began, there were only three diseases. Desire, that is Icha, which becomes passion later on. Hunger, Anasana, and senility. These are the three illnesses originally. But they multiplied to 98 as a consequence of human slaughtering animals. This is again a dig at the havans being done, animals being sacrificed in the name of worship. That is what the Vedic religion, especially Rig Veda, etc., there were sacrifice of animals. In fact, when you read the dialogues of Buddha, there are several instances where a Brahmin comes, invites him. I have a great havan, yajna, being conducted in my house, very rich man, and we are sacrificing 100,000 animals. So please do come and grace that occasion. And Buddha talks to him. He doesn't condemn him. And the way the sweet, reasonable, he keeps on talking, something like that questioning again and again. And finally, this man says, Lord, I don't want to do this. It's a very moving how his sheer personality, how he is able to talk to him. What he was doing is essentially sinful. You should not take lives like this. So he came because if a rich man sacrificed 10,000 animals, another man would sacrifice 20,000. So his sacrifice becomes greater. More people come to take part in the ceremony like this. That was the practice at that time. And this was systematically eliminated by Buddha. So here, when they say the diseases that we have, they are the wages of sin, of killing all these animals. That is what it says. And common diseases, these are all frequently mentioned: abdominal flatulence, vata disorders, musculoskeletal disorders, in other words, diseases of pallor, anemia. There is some confusion between anemia and jaundice, but that is also there. Dysentery, a feared disease because mortality was very high. Diabetes mellitus, mentioned, but no treatment is mentioned. Daraka chikitsa. Daraka is, there is no such word in Ayurveda. It is obviously balaka chikitsa, which was, they called it daraka in those days. But there are no details available how they treated children. Wet nurses, there are detailed accounts of that, how to select them, how they could influence the growth of these children. Gynecologic problems which should disqualify women from ordination. Mother, father, chetana, these three were the basis for the growth, for the birth of an embryo, agents in the formation of an embryo. There is no detailed description in Ayurveda. There is a very great detail how an embryo is formed. Here there are no details except this. There is a paternal element, maternal element, and there is a spirit element, which is called chetana. That is all it says. But there is a much more evolved form of this same theme being discussed in Ayurveda. And Vishuddhimagga and Milinda Pandhol, they both refer to fetal development. They knew that it forms and then grows, but the time horizons, etc., they are not mentioned, unlike in Ayurveda. But the subject did merit consideration, even in the Buddhist texts. And then we come to medical treatment. How did they treat these diseases? Snake bite was feared. Snakes were classified. Herbal decoctions, cow's urine, ash, clay, charms, and sucking of blood from the site. These were the measures used in treating snake bites. And Ghritas, oil, honey, molasses, 5 kinds of salts, and chunam for chronic ulcers. I mentioned that for cauterization. These were all used in treatment. And vegetable kingdom, 5 groups. Under each there are subgroups described. Large number of medicinal plants were used, and Professor Jyotir Mitra of Banaras University, who had done a special study of this subject, he has counted 435 medicinal plants are mentioned, but frequent use is only referred to in 60 medicinal plants. And the use of metals, they do not find a mention, at least as far as I could make out. I don't find any metals being used in treatment. In other words, Rasa Shastra did not seem to have existed at that time. Then medical procedures, emesis, purgation, and nasal purging. All these three, they have their own names like Utha Virechana, Atho Virechana, etc. But in today, they are known as emesis is Vamana, purgation is Virechana, and nasal purging is Nasya. All these three procedures are used in Ayurveda extensively today as part of Panchakarma. When disturbed, doshas are plentiful in the body and you want to eliminate them. These are the methods used in Ayurveda, but essentially the same procedures were used in Buddha's time. And before doing these evacuative procedures, they have to be prepared by administering fatty substances called snehana and fermentation, body fermentation like in a Turkish bath. This had to be done and then followed by these evacuative procedures. Now essentially this was done in Buddha's time. But I have not been able to find a clear reference just to enemas as a part of this, because enemas are extremely important, perhaps more important than any of these in Ayurveda as part of Panchakarma. But I have not been able to find a clear reference to enemas in the Buddhist literature that I have looked at. Now, when it comes to surgical treatment of diseases, again you will find surgical treatment is advised specifically for intussusception, that is telescoping one intestinal loop into another, that is intussusception, especially in children, tumors, fluid discharge from different body chambers, body cavities, blisters, which are abscesses, and anal fistula and ulcer. All these surgical treatment, there are recommendations, reports of that, and cleaning of wounds, application of cautery, topical application, dressings, all these are mentioned as surgical procedures. And head and neck surgery was classified separately from general surgery, which is again a practice which we follow today. Now we come to Jivaka, Buddha's physician. A little time on this extraordinary figure is well worth it. He was an orphan in Pataliputra, which was the capital of the kingdom, the Mauryan Empire. And he was found as an orphan on the doorstep of the palace one morning. And Bimbisara was the king, and Bimbisara's son Abhaya, he saw this orphan there, and he picked up that orphan and brought him to the palace and brought him as a prince. And as he grew up, he was a precocious child. When he was a teenager, he realized he was not really a prince. He was an orphan. So he became conscious of this. He said, I'm going to make myself something. I don't want to live here like this. So he left Pataliputra and traveled all the way to Takshashila. You can imagine the distance from Patna today to Takshashila in Pakistan. Now that distance, it's interesting because Takshashila was already very famous as a center for medical studies. And for Jivaka to go all the way to Takshashila, that means he had bypassed Banaras. There is some argument about, I'll come to that later, the time of Sushruta. When did he live? This is a controversial subject. if Sushruta was obviously based in Banaras, and if he had been very active as a surgeon, the Sushruta school flourished in Banaras, why would Jivaka bypass Banaras and go all the way? Obviously, the Sushruta had died and it had ceased to be a major center. That's why he went all the way to Takshashila. So, Takshashila, when he arrived there, the teacher there was an Atreya. We don't know which Atreya, there are several Atreyas. He was impressed with this boy who came all the way, not as a prince, but as an ordinary person. He had no money. So then he said, "Sir, I have no money." He was asked, "Do you have money to pay the fees?" He said, "I have no money, but I am willing to do service." It was allowed in universities. So he was accepted as a servant. So he would do cooking, household work. That is how he studied. And there are a number of stories in Jataka tales about his brilliance. In fact, the students complained one day, this Acharya was showing too much favor to this Jivaka. So one day the teacher came to realize this. He said to all these students, "Today you go to the shop and get the price of this particular drug, a medicinal plant." So they all went there, got the information, came back. And the teacher asked, "What about this?" So, and the teacher asked about another plant. So the student said, "But you didn't ask us to find the price of that." So when he came to Jivaka, he asked about that, he gave the price. Then he asked for another, half a dozen medicinal plants, he gave the price of all these. So then the teacher said, "Jivaka, I didn't ask you to find the price of all these. Why did you?" He said, "Sir, that one plant alone, you cannot use it. After all, you are wanting to treat. So if you want to treat, you have to have all this to make that medicine." So I found out. So all the other students realized this man is a different kind of person. That was Jivaka. And when he passed from there, there are stories about his examination. When he was coming back, the teacher gave him some money because he had no money to travel. And on the way, halfway through, he ran out of that money, and there was a big building, there's a rich merchant's house. So he reached there, ran out of money. So he asked the gatekeeper, "Is there anybody who is sick in this house?" They said, "Yes, the sert's wife has a headache, very bad headache, and she has not been cured." He said, "I would like to treat. So you please tell her that I am a physician, I am coming from Takshashila." So this gatekeeper went inside and told this lady, and she said, "No, you see, how old is this physician?" He said, "He is a young man." "Yeah, no, 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 I don't want to see him, because so many wise people have tried to treat me and failed, so I don't want this young man." So he came and told Jivaka. Jivaka said, "Please tell madam, she doesn't have to pay me unless she is cured. On that condition, let me treat her." So he went there, he was allowed. And he gave a nasya procedure. He made a medicine himself, a nasal purging procedure, and she was completely cured. And her husband came, son, they were all amazed, and they loaded him with gifts, money, a chariot, horses, servants. And he came back to Pataliputra with all these riches, and he gave it all to his father, Abhaya, stepfather, gave it to him saying, "This is all yours." There is a story like that. Now that was Jivaka. He was also the first in the description, Jataka tales, refining the skull, which you do not find in Sushruta. And he removed two worms from a merchant who had severe headache, the first refining operation mentioned in Indian literature. So that was Jivaka. Now this is a picture, an interesting, it is based on a sculpture in Bharat. And this Buddha, of course, I don't have to tell you. And the two sitting there, one is the king, which is Ajatashatru, the other is Jivaka. Now this story again is interesting because Ajatashatru killed his father, Bimbisara, on the urging of Devadatta, who was a competitor, a cousin of Buddha. He killed Bimbisara, his father. So he was struck by remorse and he could not find comfort talking to anybody. And one day he wanted to become a disciple of Buddha. And Jivaka said, I'll take you to him. On a full moon night, Purnima, associated with Buddha's birth, Mahaparinirvana also. And he took him in Rajagir. That is where this Buddha's grove, 1250 disciples. And as they entered, he left his chariot outside. There was absolute silence. So Ajatasatru was frightened. So he asked Jivaka, Jivaka, are you trying to play a trick on me? Are you going to betray me to my enemies? Because how can there be 1250 people with no cough, no wheeze, such silence here? It's frightening. So he said, you come with me. And when he goes and sees the Buddha, he is completely transformed. He's a changed man. He says, may my son also have this kind of peace which prevails here, something like that. Now that particular scene is the theme of a great carving in Bharat, and this is a painting based on that. Now in medical practice, in Buddhist literature, there are three elements. One is the physician. Now physician has to have all these qualities. He has to have knowledge of texts and traditions. He has to comply with them. He has to have practical skill, ability to make a diagnosis, plan for treatment. All these he has to be able to do. Familiarity with medicinal plants, ability to identify them. But then look at the patient. That is an interesting, it is a tongue in the cheek type of description. It says, patient, there are three types. Does not recover regardless of whether treatment is given or not. Second, recovers regardless of whether treatment is perfect or not. And lastly, recovers with no treatment. So the whole purpose of treatment is being questioned in this. And this is, again, you will find this in Charaka Samhita, as I mentioned, because they had themselves doubts about the claims of medicine. Because Charaka Samhita, the Atreya's dialogue, same thing. In Ayurveda, it became four, not triad. It is quartet. They have added medications also to this. And there it says, all these four, there are four properties, four qualities each. So if all the 16 are in place, then treatment will succeed. This is what Ayurveda says. Now that theme is introduced by the Acharya, Atreya, and then all the students can respond. So one of the students says very much like this. He said, Acharya, when all we see in our practice, when all these four are in place and they have all these qualities, all the 16 are in place, patient dies. And when they are not complete, quartet may not be complete, properties may not be complete, patient recovers. So there may be, maybe the treatment and patient's recovery, they are independent of each other, something like that he says. Again, the same thing you find here. There is a certain amount of skepticism about the claims of medical practice. It was not an unquestioning faith, in other words. And this triad in medical practice, patient, we have considered the physician, patient should have good memory, courage, willingness to comply with instructions, ability to describe his symptoms. Obviously, it was not through messenger, these were being, patient directly was being interviewed. Attendant, ability to give medications, to distinguish beneficial from not beneficial, cares for the patient to comfort him, not for personal gains, does not shrink from handling patient's excrements, enjoys conversing with him on Dhamma. Now, this triad was a forerunner of the quartet which we see in Ayurveda. Now, Chinese travelers in Buddhist India, I will take only two, especially Huan Xiang, who spent several years in India in the 5th century. Already at that time, Buddhism was in decline. In many of these descriptions, you will find how the Buddhist shrines were not being looked after, how the unbelievers are having their temples. These are the Hindus. So, all that description is there. But he refers to hospitals in cities where poor patients were treated free. Physicians treated diseases mostly by diet. Even today, that is correct. Pathya, that was the central principle of treatment, medical decoctions were used and discharged patients, but they were well enough from these hospitals. And then at 7 age, they were instructed education begins in 5 vidyas. One is Shabda Vidya, that is language, Shilpa Vidya, crafts, Chikilsa Vidya, that is healthcare, Hetu Vidya, that is logic, and Athyatma Vidya, spirituality. These were all the subjects taught to the children. And Chikitsa Vidya included secret charms, medicinal stones, acupuncture. This is an interesting, this is what Hyun Sang is writing. Now, we have no evidence that acupuncture, the way Chinese they do it, we were practicing it here. But the nearest we have in Sushruta Samhita, where marmas are described, there is an interesting reference. That is for cervical adenopathy, glandular enlargement in the neck. If you make a cut, there is a spot identified on the back of the leg. That is 12 inches above the heel. I think that's what I remember. There is a marma called Indravasti. Without damaging that, you make a small incision there. That will have an effect on this. It will improve. And there are references like these very far away. But it is not mentioned anywhere else. So whether this was a rampant practice when Hyun Sang came here, he must have seen such cuts being made, not by using needles. And what kind of theory, what kind of explanation they had, we do not know. But he does mention that. Another is mugwort. Mugwort, I found out, is Ravolfia. And Ravolfia does not find a place in Charaka, Susrada or Vakpada. It is not mentioned. The first time we find Ravolfia mentioned is Garcia de Orta, who was a Goan physician who came in the 16th century, the first European to come to India and to learn medicinal plants of India and write a book, Simples, Colloquies on the Simples and Drugs of India. 53 colloquies are there, all about these medicinal plants. And there he mentions this, what he called cobra wood or Ravolfia. Extensively used in South India and Sri Lanka, that is what he says there. Used in treating fever, used in treating snake bite, used in treating mental disease. So that he mentions mugwort here. And again, going on with the Hyun Sang, there is a place he had visited in Rajgir, where a place where Buddha used to give sermons, which was built for him by Jivaka. Jivaka used to charge very large fees for his treatment, and that money he used to gift it to the Dharma, to Buddha's Sangha. So he had built a hall built for Buddha's sermons, and Jivaka's own house was not far away, and the remnants of those existed during Hyun Sang visits. He talks about that. And he also went to Amaravati. He talks about Nagarjuna, who was a great alchemist. There is a lot of description about that, showing that already Rasa Shastra had gained considerable ground in India by that time. And sick people fast for 7 days when most get well. This is his observation. Thereafter, they consult physicians who give medications. Then we come to the spread of Ayurvedic ideas through Buddhist channels, a very interesting chapter in the history of medicine. Ayurveda is practiced all over India with regional variations, like Panchakarma being done in Kerala or in Rajasthan. They would not be identical. There would be small changes in the techniques. But Ayurvedic ideas like Tridosha, Pathya, Panchakarma, herbal extracts, all these different ideas, they traveled all over India to many parts of Asia, such as Tibet, Nepal, Central Asia, Korea, Japan, Indonesia, etc., Sri Lanka, Cambodia, through Buddhist channels. That is how they spread. And the Chinese pilgrims, Fa Hian, before Hyun Sang and Hyun Sang, they spread these ideas in China, 4th and 5th centuries. Not to replace Chinese medicine, but the ideas were known in China. And this great spread was facilitated by many things. One is, everybody had access to this. There were no restrictions. Unlike Ayurveda, initiation into Ayurveda, Brahmins were preferred, Kshatriyas were accepted, Vaishyas were also accepted, but Shudras were not accepted. If they were accepted, it was grudgingly accepted. All these restrictions were there. But Buddhist, there was no restriction whatsoever. Everybody was accepted. Second, Sanskrit was taught to learners of Ayurveda. There was no restriction in Sanskrit learning. And many of the early Ayurvedic texts were written in Sanskrit. So, unless you knew Sanskrit, there was no way you could become an Ayurvedic physician. And there was no restriction. And regional languages were used freely in teaching. Like Pali became such a religious language because Pali was the common man's language. And pre-existing regional practices in healthcare, they were adopted into medical practice willingly. Now, these were all the reasons association with Buddha's name. All these helped in the spread of these ideas all over. Now, this is a picture of a typical local practice of Kerala, which had been adopted into Ayurveda. And this is a practice called Dhara, where a special vessel, I think you can see that lady is holding a vessel called Kindi. It's a specially shaped vessel where oil of mild heat that is being poured gently on that diseased part, maybe head or a joint, etc. Now, that was a practice which is only in Kerala you will see this Dhara, which is used even today quite extensively. And this is, of course, even more famous, Pidichil, for which lots of people go to Kerala nursing homes to get this done. This is cloth soaked in warm oil, medicated oil, which is used to massage, which is applied and gentle massage is given. This is being done on a special a wooden cot with a concave surface, that is where the man or the woman lies, and this is done in this manner. And these are extremely popular. Many patients, especially musculoskeletal disorders, where lots of people come from different parts of India, from other countries, and they come every year. It cannot be just once you do it and you are cured. That doesn't happen for these musculoskeletal disorders. Often conditions like osteoarthritis, you cannot cure them, but they become manageable. And then we have to talk about a Bauer manuscript, an interesting story about the history. Colonel Bauer was an Englishman, and an Englishman was murdered in India by a group of people from Central Asia, and they ran away from here. And Colonel Bauer chased them. It was a punitive expedition, and he went all the way to Kucha in Central Asia. And there, he found in an old monastery a manuscript. He did not know the value of it. Having accomplished his major objective, he came back to India and he gave it to the Asiatic Society in Calcutta. And Dr. Hohenle, a great German scholar, he edited this. It's known as the Bauer manuscript. And it turns out to be an invaluable book. It was probably written by somebody from North India or maybe Eastern Turkmenistan. And it talks about an assembly of sages in the Himalaya, something very much like the Sushruta Samhita. And there is a query from Sushruta, and Kashi Raja Divodasa is giving the replies. That is how the whole thing is written. But if you look at that, many of the references are prior to Charaka Samhita. There is no reference to Charaka Samhita. Obviously, this book was written before Charaka Samhita. So, it is of great historical value. And that talks about Vata, Pitta, Kapha. In other words, this was written, we can assume, when Buddhism was the dominant religion. But it again adds, blood is also a fourth dosha, which is a doctrine you find in Sushruta Samhita. You do not find it in Charaka or Vagpata. So, it only illustrates the Bauer manuscript in Central Asia, how dominant Buddhism of Ayurveda was even at that time, before Charaka, in Central Asia. So, therefore, the traditional medicine in Buddhist India was undoubtedly the forerunner of Ayurveda of today. And the basic doctrines, which I have already covered extensively, Panchabhuta, Tridosha, food and drinks, rules of healthy living, disease and treatment, medicinal formulations, Panchakarma, surgical procedures, the triad in medical practice, these were all notable in the practice of medicine in Buddhist India. and they became fully developed in Ayurveda. And Buddhist ring, Charaka and Sushruta, you will find they are clearly audible. For example, Sushruta, Charaka talks about Kshanika Vijnana. What you see today, tomorrow when you come, suppose there is a river, this is our river here, and tomorrow you come or 2 hours later, the river is still there, but the water is not the same. It is all gone. All of us are changing like that. So therefore, the knowledge is limited to that particular moment. This kind of highly philosophical ideas, Kshanika Vijnana, it is only transientness of knowledge. This which Sushruta Charaka talks about is essentially from Buddhism. So therefore, that Buddhist ring is audible in Charaka as well as Sushruta. But Vagpada, he was himself a self-declared Buddhist. So that is the very important role the Buddhist period played in the development of Ayurveda of today.